this is Erica with Launching Legacies. Welcome to our daily devotional. Today we are starting a series on me being a fear bully. And so this is a personal testimony. You'll learn if you watch me enough or if you work with me individually that I tell a lot of my own stories. I believe wholehearted in transparency because I think that that leads us to healing. And it helps us to understand that we're never fully alone in our suffering, in our rejoicing, in our struggles, in our deliverance, in our need for healing. We're never fully alone. And so I want to share with you this process. And actually over this week, we will go through a process of how the Lord is healing me from being a fear bully. But today we need to set the groundwork. I need to explain to you how I became what I'm referring to as a fear bully, what that looks like, and why it should be avoided. And then we'll walk day by day through the process of deliverance. So here goes the trick. This is something I'm currently struggling walking with the Lord through into deliverance, and he's showing and revealing things to me as I about my heart, about my position, about my behavior that need to be changed. So what does that mean? That if you are in the same place as me, or if you've done the same behavior, or if you can identify with the behavior, or if you know somebody who acts the same way, then you can join with me in the process of becoming well in this area. And if you don't understand it, if you haven't been through it, but you're going to go through it, you can reference this place as an understanding of what to avoid. And if you never going to go through it because it's just not your personality type or not something you struggle with, then you can pray for us as we receive our healing in this area. So what am I saying? This is devotional for everyone is basically what I'm saying. If it's you, then come through it with me. If it's not you and it's going to be you, then learn some lessons. If it used to be you, thank God for your deliverance. And if you know somebody, pray for them. Okay. And so let's talk about this concept of a fear bully. Okay. So we think about, it's really interesting to me because for me as a child, I was the person who defended the person who was being mistreated. And it was a big part of my childhood life because I experienced abuse in school when I was very young in kindergarten, and I knew the pain that it caused. And so because of the pain that I experienced when I was being abused by my kindergarten teacher and my first grade teacher, I really didn't want any person to suffer. And so what I became was this kind of superhero kid, I guess, that would befriend the child that was being mistreated. So the PP kid, you know, the child that has some issue with either wetting the bed or some bladder incontinence. Everybody knows about this kid that goes to school with you when you were little kids. At least it was when we were younger. They didn't have those larger size diapers, or maybe the family was too poor to afford it, and the child would smell like pee all the time, and you couldn't figure out why the child smelled like pee, but other kids would be mean to them and they would bully them. I remember there was a child like that, and I was so hurt by their suffering that I would take it upon myself to befriend them, even if it cost me something. I didn't want anybody to feel like they were left out. That became an anthem in my life, and actually it became an anthem because I knew the suffering and I just didn't want anybody to suffer. And so very close to my heart is that we be restorative and that we make people well. And so I was a defender of the bullies. And so imagine my surprise when just a few days ago, I started to understand that I had in fact been a bully myself, and that I had bullied not just people who I didn't know, but I hadn't bullied the people I didn't really know, but more intimately, I had bullied those who were close to me. And I wasn't the typical bully, and so that's why I didn't even identify that that's what's happening. And so So this is very difficult. It still is very difficult, a process for me, because I look at myself and I think, how can I help people be well? How can I help people be restored? I never look at myself and think, how can I cause suffering or how can I cause pain? And I'm not any unique person in that way. I'm not, you know, Mother Teresa or anything like that. I don't think that most people look at others and figure out how they can cause them to suffer or how they can cause pain in their life. But I think what we end up doing is in our our areas of brokenness and our areas of sin and our areas of dysfunction, we can find ourselves in the most unlikely of places. And for me, that was the place of being the bully. That's where I found myself. And so let's progress. So I don't think it's a mystery. I think I've talked about it at enough for you to understand that I experienced a lot of abuse in my childhood. Different people from different angles, from teachers in school to sexual abuse as a child, and trauma as a teenager. And so what happened over time was that I started to think really poorly of people, particularly the people who were victimizers. If I felt like a person was a bully, or if a person was going to do harm, or a person had bad intentions, my idea, my impression of them was that they kind of went into the pot of all these other people who had done wrong, who had been wrong, who had made these bad decisions. And so what that's called, though, when we create a collection for people to kind of be in, right? And we start to sort people out and say, okay, you're a good person, you can be over here. Okay, you're an abuser, you can be over here. Is really the people that you put as an abuser, or you put as the people who are bad, those people become people that you're actually afraid of, right? You're afraid of their potential to do harm. And so what I really developed in my categorizing people was that I created a whole place in which I feared man, and not just man, but the capacity of man to cause suffering. And because I had endured so much suffering, I just started to categorize people in that way. And I really wasn't very clear to me till a few weeks ago, when I was going through some healing of my own, that I had even done that. And so I renounced that idea of categorizing people. But what came with that categorizing of people was a way to identify how they got into their categories. And so what I looked at was, if a person was behaving a certain kind of way, if they were dishonest, if they lacked integrity, if they were somehow like a chauvinist, or had some kind of outwardly visible way of being, then I would immediately start to take note of that, and they would be shuffled along into the pot of the people who I would say, I'm not going to let this person very close because there's a possibility that they're going to do harm. That whole system is wrong, though, right? The truth of the matter is, we all have the capacity to do harm. Not from the most sweet person to the most nefarious of us all, we all have the capacity to hurt, and we all will be hurt in life. And so it doesn't really work, but that's what I started to do. And so I started looking at these key characteristics, and when I started to make my inner circle of people who I trusted, those characteristics were the things that prevented a person from being a part of it. So if I felt like a person was dishonest, and I would watch people and I would say, okay, yeah, they're not honest. They lied about that. Okay, they lied about that. And I might have a little bit of grace, but the grace didn't extend very long. As soon as I saw them being deceptive about a certain thing over a pattern of time, or if they told lies that didn't need to be told, if they behaved in a certain kind of way, I start to shuffle them in the direction of people I did not trust. And really, they became a part of a group of people who couldn't get very close to me because I feared that you would be a dangerous person. Again, it's erroneous. Those who are closest to you are likely to do the most harm because they're closest to you. Part of vulnerability is that you expose yourself to being harmed. But what happened is, as I started to make these distinctives, this list of things that people could do in order to be put in this shuffling of people I don't want close to me, I had a demand then on those in my inner circle who hadn't behaved this way, or who hadn't demonstrated this way. And the demand was, you better not act like one of these people that are in this category. Because if you act like one of the people in this category, you risk the potential of being taken out of my inner circle and cutting off relationship in order for me to protect myself, because I didn't want to be endangered anymore. But also, it wasn't just for protection of myself. The fear was that you will also become like one of them. And because I love you, I don't want you to be like one of them. And because being like one of them is dangerous, I don't want you to be like one of them. But if you choose to be like one of them, then you're choosing to cut off relationship. And it's just not the way that love works, but it is the way that fear works. And so fear created a bully in me. And I hope that you understand the process that I went through. But I literally just started shuffling people based on their behaviors, based on their interactions with me, based on the things that they chose. I started literally shuffling them into these places and putting them into a hold based on these expectations of what good people do and what not so good people do. And I would categorize them like that. Now, it wasn't every person, because I'm a counselor, so you can imagine that I work with people who are always dysfunctional. People lie to me a lot. Counselors get lied to a lot. And it's more so because the person's shame or their insecurities or their lack of trust. They don't want to tell the truth because they're afraid of being put into some kind of position. Those people I didn't really struggle with, because in my mind they were sick. And so if they're sick, it's okay. You lie, you're just gonna do it. People lie to me, like I said, all the time. So it was okay, I'm treating you. We're going through the process, you're gonna be healed. So I had more grace for those who were unwell, because I kind of considered them people who were trying to be better, who were working on it, so they weren't put into that pot. But people who were in my inner circle were held to a higher standard. And those are the people I love the most, but those are the people who would be really, they would be subject to the most scrutiny. They were the people that I bullied. I didn't give them the freedom to make mistakes, because I feared that their mistakes would be damnation to them as an individual, would mean they were bad people. But then also I feared that their mistakes would be harmful to me. And having endured as much abuse as I did in a lifetime, I just didn't want to hurt anymore. I just didn't want to be in pain anymore. And I didn't want them to be in pain anymore. And I didn't want them to cause anybody else's pain. And I didn't want to cause them pain, but I didn't realize that by doing that, by setting that standard, I was hurting them. I hope you're ready for this journey with me. It's a long journey. It's a painful journey. It doesn't feel good. I will try not to cry over the next week, but no telling what will happen. This is what I can promise you though. I can promise you that if you identify with this place or any of the other places I'm going to talk about throughout this week, then you're not alone. And I'm praying for you. I'm praying for myself. I hope you're praying for me, but I'm also praying for you that one, listen, I share this story because I know we have to be free. There isn't a place, there isn't a time, there isn't an understanding that we get to sit on and hem and ha about. No, we got to choose to go to God and let him make us well, because we cannot be the people who cause suffering. If we are, we are not the salt and we are not the light. And we cannot bully even the closest to us and hope that they understand. We can't do it. We can't even bully those who we don't know and say, don't worry, they won't even remember who we are later on. No, because God doesn't get glory from that either. We have to be people who do not live in fear, not fear of man, or feel a fear of possibilities. We have to be people who are free, because he who the Son sets free is free indeed. I want to give you a scripture reference that we're going to be looking at as we go through this process, and that is 1 John 4:18. It talks about perfect love casting out all fear, and that really when we allow the love of God to come in, we remove this place of fear that I have lived in, that has caused me to be a bully, and we find ourselves in the love of God and his abiding ability to make us well and make our relationships well. Will you join me again tomorrow with another devotional? I'll be praying for you. Like I said, will you please be praying for me? I'll see you again tomorrow. Until then, be blessed.